morning, folks. Top of the morning. Oh, man.
I hope everybody's, you know what, well rested, ready for a great and amazing day. Oh, man, it's Tuesday. We're here. We just finished an amazing week 5 of football, and there's so much to talk about. So let's go ahead and hop right into it. This is the breakdown. X's and O's with Nate Ness. I'm your host, Nate Ness, and wow. Week 5. Each week we're getting a treat. Just amazing football, amazing competitiveness on the field. You know, you got your ups and your downs. You know, you got your, oh, why are they doing this dumb play? You know, those moments as a fan and whatnot. But still, say nonetheless, it's just an amazing week 5, and just we got a lot to go ahead and dive into it. So let's go ahead and do it. So we're going back over to London. This is the second consecutive week that we've had a game in London. And if you guys know anything, what Roger Goodell is trying to do, he's trying to make the game football on a universal platform, very similar to the likes of baseball and very similar to the likes of soccer. Those are universal, you know, sports and whatnot. So he's trying to really, again, expand the game and the brand of football. Now, one thing that's loving, like, you know, that's amazing is that, you know, a lot of these individuals, a lot of these folks, these fans, it's a lot of fans overseas. They don't get a chance to experience, you know, the game and to be able to attend the game. It's amazing. You know, they get a chance to have one in their own backyard. And I can tell you right now, Tottenham Stadium, because I played in it, is an amazing stadium. The fans come out there and they show mad love. They show just appreciation to again, all the players that come over there, you know what, all the events they have over there leading up to the game. So, again, this is an amazing feeling. So, the Green Bay Packers, they take on the New York Giants. Now, this is a home game, technically, for the New York Giants. Now, again, the Giants, they came out looking very, very well. I mean, again, they looked very well. One thing I love about Coach Brian Daboll, because he's my actual pick right now. He's the number one candidate for Coach of the Year. He hasn't asked Daniel Jones to be Superman. Just play within the confines of the team. You know, play mistake-free football. Don't go out there and think you got to do too much. And one thing I love what he's doing, he's revived Saquon Barkley. Saquon Barkley looks like a different guy out there. It looks like the rookie Saquon Barkley. So, Daniel Jones was 21 for 27 on the day, with 217 yards, pretty efficient day. He also carried the ball 10 times, 37 yards. Saquon Barkley, 13 carries for 70 yards, looked really good running the ball, and one rushing touchdown. Now, Gary Brightwell and Darren Berlinger, they both had rushing touchdowns each. And Darius Slayton, he was the only receiver that really got going, with 6 receptions for 79 yards. Now, on the other side, Packers, Aaron Rodgers, he was decent. You know, he's not, again, he hasn't been throwing up the crazy numbers that we are accustomed to seeing Aaron Rodgers do, but he was decent none the least. 25 for 39 for 222 yards and 2 touchdowns. Aaron Jones led the Packers on the ground with 13 carries for 63 yards, and A.J. Dillon chipped in 6 carries for 34 yards. So they got solid production from their running backs. Randall Cobb led the receivers with 7 receptions for 99 yards, and Alan Lazard had 4 receptions for 35 yards and 1 receiving touchdown, and Mercedes Lewis had another receiving touchdown. Now, really solid game, really solid game. I mean, again, we have overlooked the Giants for years. Again, they haven't given us anything to be hopeful for with them and how they played, but they played very, very good. And the Packers, for the most part, they were in control of this game. But again, as I said before in the beginning, I have to commend Brian Daboll and his game plan and the executing of this game plan, and then how the defense is playing. A good combination of running pass and some solid stops on the defensive side, the Giants was able to turn the second half and score 17 points. Again, 17 points, including 14 in the fourth quarter, to take this game from the Packers, 27-22. So congratulations, Giants. All right, we're heading back to New York now, to the States, where Pittsburgh Steelers visit the Buffalo Bills. Now, this is the first game that rookie Kenny Pickett is going to get his, like, you know, he got his chance, he got his taste of welcome to the NFL. Now, really, really solid numbers to say, like, a lot of passing yards, 35 of 52 for 327 yards, 1 interception. But, again, the Steelers, they played from behind the whole game. Jalen Warren, he was a leading rusher with 5 carries for 24 yards because they limited Najee Harris. Now, George Pickens, he led them with 6 receptions for 83 yards, while Deontay Johnson chipped in 5 for 60, and Chase Claypool, another 5 receptions for 50 yards. But let's go ahead and talk about the Bills. The Bills are perceived to be the best team in the NFL, and they looked the part like yesterday. Josh Allen, who, again, is in the MVP conversation of everybody, he's probably the top player in all MVP discussions. He had a solid game. 20 for 31, 424 yards, 4 touchdowns, 1 interception, and he also carried the ball 5 times for 42 yards. Now, Devin Singletary, he also carried the ball 6 times for 42 yards, and James Cook, rookie, had 4 carries for 31 yards and a touchdown. Now, this is where it gets interesting in the passing game, because in the passing game, Josh Allen torched him, and he had a lot of receivers that actually showed up big in the big moment. Gabe Davis, he had 3 receptions for 171 yards and 2 touchdowns, including this beautiful 98-yard bomb. Stephon Diggs, who is a monster. 8 receptions for 102 yards and another touchdown. And Khalil Shakir had 3 receptions for 75 yards and a touchdown. But it's nothing much really just you can say about this game. I just read all the stats. All you can see is that the Bills dominate this game from the opening draw. The Bills did what they wanted to do, and Josh Allen, he had another great game. Now, this Bills offense as a whole, it dominated. The wide receivers, Gabe Davis, Stephon Diggs, and Khalil Shakir, they torched that Steelers secondary. Now, Kenny Pickett, again, got his first start. You know what? And I'm quite sure that they're, you know what? They gave him the reins. He's supposed to be their franchise quarterback. They got to ride with him now. It just wasn't a great day for the Steelers offense, who fell behind early, and they couldn't really establish their game plan. You know, the Steelers, they want to run the ball. I mean, you got a rookie quarterback under center. You want to run the ball to make the game easy for him to control the clock. But the Bills erupted in the second quarter, scoring 21 points, and they held the Steelers scoreless for three quarters as they dominated the game 38-3. All right. Now we're going back to Cleveland, where the L.A. Chargers visit the Cleveland Browns. Now, again, this is another great game. Two good running teams that have, like, you know, amazing offensive lines and amazing running games. Justin Herbert, solid on the day, real quiet day, 22 for 34 for 228 yards, one touchdown. Austin Eckler exploded for a big game. So all you fantasy owners who had Austin Eckler playing in the game, you scored big. 16 carries for 173 yards and one touchdown. And he also had 4 receptions for 26 yards and another touchdown. Joshua Kelly also chipped in 10 carries for 49 yards and a touchdown. And Mike Williams led the receivers with 10 receptions for 134 yards. Now, not a really great day for Jacoby Brissett, but you know what? The Browns were in it. Jacoby Brissett went 21-34 for 230 yards, one touchdown, one interception. And the Browns running backs, they went off as well. Nick Chubb leading the way with 17 carries for 134 yards, two touchdowns. And Kareem Hunt chipped in 11 carries for 47 yards and another touchdown. This is a game where the running game, like, you know what, running game just took off. The ground game, the ground and pound, was, it couldn't be stopped. David Njoku, he led the Browns in receiving with 6 receptions for 88 yards, and Amari Cooper chipped in 7 receptions for 76 yards and a receiving touchdown. But, like I said, very solid competitive game between two good rushing offenses. And the Chargers, they got a monster game from their back, Austin Eckler, who had just really solid production overall. And that's what Austin Eckler has done. He does it on the ground and in the passing game. Overall, just solid production. Yet, say the same things about the Browns, who got solid production from their running backs, Kareem Hunt and Nick Chubb. But what it came down to the fourth quarter. And the offensive struggles like that both teams had, the score. And the Chargers, they did just enough in that fourth quarter to get the victory, 30-28. All right, AFC South Showdown. Houston Texans go on to Jacksonville to take on the Jaguars. Now, Davis Mills, it was okay. I mean, not really much in a passing game. 16 for 24 for 140 yards. Damian Pierce, he actually led them on the ground because this was a ground game for them because the running game was actually working for them. 26 carries for 99 yards and one touchdown. And Nico Collins, he led the receivers with 4 receptions for 65 yards. Now, Trevor Lawrence had a really, really off day, to say the least. 25 for 47 for 286 yards and 2 interceptions. And Travis Etienne, he led them on the ground with 10 carries for 71 yards. Marvin Jones had a nice game with 7 receptions for 104 yards, and Evan Ingram chipped in 6 for 69. But this is a low-scoring affair. Division game between two division opponents who know each other very, very well. Again, the Jaguars, they have more in total offense than the Texans. But the thing that killed them was that they were 0-3 in red zone efficiency and 2 big turnovers. That's not a formula for winning football, especially when you're in a red zone you can't convert. If you're in a red area, you're expected to get some points out of that. Again, this game is about who can score the most points and what team, how you can limit the opposing team from scoring points. But this game was more about the mistakes of Trevor Lawrence and the Jaguars offense. But the Texans, they won the game, and they won a big game. Yep, they get this one 13-6. All right, we got an NFC North showdown. Now, I'm gonna tell you something about the NFC North. You know, Green Bay, Detroit, Minnesota, and Chicago. It's a competitive division, and it's in the cold. I played there my last 2 years in the league, and it gets active up there. So, Chicago Bears take on the Minnesota Vikings. Now, Justin Fields, one of the things that have just really got me with Chicago and Justin Fields is that, again, his passing, like, you know, taking the step and the next step and just his development as a quarterback. Now, he's been, like, kind of hampered, you know what I mean? Again, but they're winning games, but, again, now you got to open it up. You got to expect more from this second year signal caller. Again, coming from your rookie year to your second year, you got to make that jump. You got to make that jump to be on the path to becoming elite. But you got to also be able, the game should be slowing down for you. You should be studying more and just really getting into that groove a lot easier. Now, Justin Fields has had, like, you know, some weeks where he's only had 70 passing yards. He's had very limited throwing. and the Bears' passing offense is very, very last. It's dead last in the NFL. But he had a solid game, going 15 for 21 for 208 yards, and he had one touchdown. But he also carried the ball 8 times for 47 yards. David Montgomery, who's had, like, you know, great games, he was actually limited to 12 carries for 20 yards, but he did have one rushing touchdown. And he also chipped in 4 receptions for 62 yards. Now, Venus Jones, he had 1 receiving touchdown. But on the other side, the Vikings are a great team. I mean, they have so much star power on that offense and on that team in itself. Good defense, good skill position from running backs to the receivers and the tight end. And again, Kirk Cousins, you have all of these weapons. It's time for him to take that step. He's had his weeks where he's been good, and he's come back and he's laid an egg. But this game wasn't too bad. 32 for 41 for 296 yards, 1 touchdown, 1 interception, and he also had 1 rushing touchdown. Dalvin Cook looked amazing for the part and controlled the game. 18 carries for 94 yards and 2 touchdowns. And Justin Jefferson. I know we all talk about Devontae Adams. We talk about Devontae Adams, we talk about Tyreek, we talk about the Cheetah. You know, but JJ, that's a grown man out there playing football. And he has had some monster weeks, and this guy is just getting better and better. The thing about it is, he has not tapped his true potential. He's going off of just raw athletic ability, but once he understands the game, understands the nuances of the position as a wide receiver, he is going to be better and better. 12 receptions for 154 yards, and Irv Smith chipped in 4 receptions for 42 yards. But NFC North division game, and you got a solid showing for the Vikings. You know, again, if the consistency, you just got to get that consistent showing from the Vikings. And the Vikings, they're a enigma. I'm telling you, just again, they are a funny enigma. This team checks all the boxes and star power on the offense, and they have a really, really good defense. They look good one week. Her cousins look like he can be an MVP candidate. But then he'll come back and lay it. And it's just like, wow, you got to take it. For this team to really take that next step, they're going to need their quarterback to take the next step. Justin Jefferson, again, as I said before, grown man out there. And Dalvin Cook, when he's healthy, he's a force to be reckoned with. And this Vikings offense is hard to game plan. But again, Justin Fields, he didn't have great numbers, but again, he got his team to really, you know, compete. But they fall to the Vikings. All right, time to head to New England. All right, where the New England Patriots host the Detroit Lions. Now, this Detroit Lions, their record does not speak, again, about the intangibles of this team, how good this team is. They were the top overall offense in the NFL coming into this week. This team scores points. Passing, rushing the ball, but most of the time they're playing from behind, so they really just let it fly. Now this Detroit team is so, like, if you look at them, they don't just give up. They don't just go out there and lay down. They compete, and they compete their asses off. Jared Goff hasn't been the best, but he's looked really good. And it's like just getting them to, have a complete game offensively, defensively, and on special teams. It's just, that's all they need, because ultimately what it comes down to is one mistake that they make, and it's like, whether it's starting slow and finishing fast or starting fast and finishing slow, you got to get a complete game. Jared Goff, 19-35 for 229 yards, 1 interception. Jamal Williams led the ground game with 15 carries for 56 yards. And Josh Reynolds had 6 receptions for 92 yards. Now, Patriots, on the other hand, they were starting their rookie third-string quarterback, Bailey Zappi. Now, again, we know he came in last week to play against the Green Bay Packers. He looked good in that game. Looked solid in this one. He went 17-21, efficient game, 188 yards, 1 touchdown, 1 interception. But the game was really won on the ground game, as Ramondre Stevenson had 25 carries for 161 yards. Jacoby Myers was the leading receiver with 7 receptions for 111 yards, and he had 1 receiving touchdown. But again, Patriots, they use this game to get back on track, and that's what they wanted to do, get back on track in the win column. You know, Bailey Zappi had a nice game. His numbers weren't eye-popping. His numbers aren't attractive in, like, you know, 300, 400 yards, but it was a solid overall performance for the team. And Ramondre Stevenson, he provided a big boost for the offense, and the offensive line did an amazing job paving the way for him. You know what, the Patriots controlled the pace of the game. Patriots defense, you know what, they was able to slow down the Lions offense and slow them down, this top 10, top 3 ranked offense and shut them out. Now, the Patriots, they actually get back on top and get back on track with their rookie third-string quarterback, and they win in dominating fashion, 29-0. All right, to the Big Easy we go, with Seattle Seahawks travel to take on the New Orleans Saints. Now, I know a lot of us weren't even thinking about this at the beginning of the season. You know what? When the Seahawks got Geno Smith, and he was going to be the starting quarterback. A lot of people, including myself, we were scratching our head. Because, I mean, again, we know how Geno plays. Geno is not, like, you know, the best and most reliable quarterback. But I must say, I had to eat my workers because he's looked amazing in the first part of this season. And he looked good yesterday. 16 for 25 for 268 yards, 3 touchdowns, no interceptions. Now, oh, this is a heartbreaker right here. Rashad Penny, who was having a monster year. 8 carries, 54 yards in the game, but he'll be out for the whole season with a broken tibia. Oh, man, he was looking great, too. Tyler Lockett had a big game. 5 receptions, 440 yards, 2 touchdowns. And DK Metcalf, he chipped in 5 receptions for 88 yards and another touchdown. But DK dropped a couple passes, and you got to get that cleaned up. As a receiver, like DK Metcalf, who commands, you know what, again, so much attention, doubling and bracketing, you have to actually, you have to game plan for him and shift your coverage and roll your coverage to him to make sure he doesn't get on the line. You got to make sure you're catching those balls right there. You got to make sure, pause. You got to make sure you're catching and receiving those passes and just making a difference in the game. But the Saints, they look good. Andy Dalton, he started again under center, and he was decent, you know, good enough to win. 16 for 24 for 187 yards, 1 touchdown, 1 interception. Taysom Hill, whoever had Taysom Hill on their fantasy team, you ate yesterday. And this guy, the Swiss Army knife, the quarterback, the running back, the special teamer, the tight end, you know, again, this guy does it all for the Saints. 9 carries for 112 yards, 3 touchdowns, and he also went 1 for 1 as he had a 22-yard touchdown pass. Great production for Taysom Hill. Alvin Kamara, they welcomed him back, and he looked good. 23 carries for 103 yards, 6 receptions for 91 yards. And that's what Alvin Kamara does. Him and Taysom Hill, if you have them both in the game at the same time, in that pony personnel, that means 2 backs, no tight ends, or all your receivers, again, you can do whatever you want with them because, again, you got to account for Taysom Hill's throwing ability on top of the fact that he can run the ball. He can also block very, very well. And Alvin Kamara, he's not just your running back. He's a guy that, you know what, again, he runs the ball in between the tackles, but he also can go out there and flex as a receiver and punish any linebacker or safety that's guarding him. But a great competitive game between two teams. Again, another solid week for Geno Smith. You know, back-to-back weeks of solid production. He's actually fared a lot better than Russell Wilson this season. Man, the Saints, they had a great offensive outing. Again, the production between Alvin Kamara and Taysom Hill, I mean, that's amazing. And it's kind of hard to game plan for that because, again, what these two guys, what they bring to the table, what, like, you know, with how threatening they are on the offensive side, whether it's running the ball, passing the ball, or receiving the ball. But the Seahawks, they got a lot of bigger fish to fry. You know, they need to find a solid pass rush. Again, they do not have no pressure on these quarterbacks, and these quarterbacks are actually laying in the pocket and just, you know, go through and pick them apart. And this is not what we're accustomed to seeing from a Coach Carroll defense. But again, they gotta fix their mistakes. But the Saints get this win right in Taysom Hill's monster game, 39-32. All right, to the Meadowlands we go. As my old team, the Miami Dolphins, go and take on the New York Jets in the AFC East showdown. Now, crazy game. Now we know about the concussion protocols and whatnot because of everything that's happened with Tua last week and the week up before. Now, Teddy Bridgewater, he was knocked out in the very first play from scrimmage with a concussion and ruled out. You know, again, the very first play. So, you know, they're actually watching, again, with everything that's happened with Tua and other players with concussions, they're actually taking the initiative to be a lot more proactive with head injuries. So, Ricky Thompson, he came in, and he got his welcome to the NFL moment. You know, rookie 7th-round draft pick, 1933, 166 yards, 1 interception. He struggled. And, again, Robert Saleh made it difficult for him. Raheem Mostert, he had a solid game. He's on my fantasy team. 18 carries for 113 yards and 1 touchdown. And Tyreek Hill led the receiver with 7 receptions for 47 yards. Now the Jets, they've been a pretty pleasant surprise this year. You know what? And just been able to do it in different ways. Zach Wilson, 14 for 21 for 210 yards and 1 rushing touchdown. Now, Breece Hall had a very, very good game. 18 carries for 97 yards and a touchdown. And Michael Carter, he also chipped in 10 carries for 21 yards and 2 touchdowns. Braxton Berrios, 1 carry for a 15-yard touchdown. And Breece Hall also led them in receiving with 2 receptions for 100 yards. Great, solid production. But AFC East showdown between the Jets and the Dolphins. And this game, like, you know, it went left quickly for the Dolphins. Again, you go in there with your game plan, and you don't expect injuries to happen, but that's part of the nature of the game. Injuries do happen. And from the very first play of scrimmage, who tells you Teddy Bridgewater, he was already filling in for the injured Tua Tagovailoa, but he was knocked out of the game. And from there, it went like completely downhill. Like again, your offense, the offensive game plan, and the play calling for Mike McDaniels and that offense, it changes drastically when you insert a rookie seventh-round draft pick in Skylar Thompson. And he had his welcome to the NFL moment. And the Dolphins offense as a whole struggled, and struggled in a big way. The Jets got so much production from its running game, and ultimately the running game was a deciding factor in this game, rushing for over 130 yards as a team and 4 rushing touchdowns. And the Jets cruised to a big victory over their rivals, 40-17.
All right.
Now we're going to head to Tampa, where we got an NFC South showdown between the Atlanta Falcons and the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Now, growing up, these games, like, you know what, back when I was playing, these games were always entertaining. You know what, you got a lot of offense in these games right here. You know what, teams just going back and forth, and it's a lot of John, and it's a physical contest. You know, Marcus Mariota and the Falcons, they started slow, and they tried to finish fast. He went 14 for 25, 147 yards, 1 touchdown, and he also had 7 carries for 61 yards. You know what, Tyler Algier had 13 carries for 45 yards, and Caleb Huntley, you guys remember that name, Huntley. You know, this guy has a story, has an amazing story and amazing background. 8 carries for 34 yards, and Avery Williams had a rushing touchdown. Olamide Zaccheaus, 2 receptions for 39 yards and 1 touchdown. But that Bucs on the other side, I mean, Tom Brady, we all know what he does. He's the GOAT, he's the greatest of all time to ever lace them up. 30 for 52 for 351 yards, 1 touchdown. Now again, for those numbers right there, this is a very, very close game. And Bucs actually look very good on offense, but they couldn't get it together. Like for some odd reason, they just kept stumbling over their own feet. Leonard Fournette, solid, 14 carries for 56 yards, 1 touchdown, and he also led them with 10 receptions for 83 yards and a receiving touchdown. While Mike Evans chipped in 4 receptions for 81 yards, and Chris Godwin had 6 for 61. Now, solid show up between the NFC South rivals, but the Bucs, they got started fast, and again, they got it going. Coming off that embarrassing loss to Kansas City, you know the Bucs actually were focused. They wanted to get back in the win column and get the offense going and moving in a positive direction. Now, it got going, but it got going slow. Tom Brady had some solid numbers, and he controlled the game. But the Bucs had a 21-point lead heading into the fourth quarter and allowed the Falcons to get back into the game. It was also some questionable roughing the pass. It was a questionable roughing the passer call that, again, I don't agree with, but again, that's the game. But the Bucs and the Bucs defense and Tom Brady, you know what? They were able to get this win and this close win, 21-15, because the Atlanta Falcons, they battled back, especially in that fourth quarter. But Bucs get this win. All right, to FedEx Field, where the Washington Commanders, they host the Tennessee Titans. Now, Tennessee actually came into this game pretty decent. This was a really, 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 really good game. I enjoyed this game on Sunday. Ryan Tannehill, solid, not big numbers, 15 for 25 for 181 yards, 1 touchdown. You don't need much from Ryan Tannehill. Just stick to the game plan. Don't go out there and try to be Superman, because guess what? You got Superman right behind you that's lined up, and that's Derrick Henry. Derrick Henry had a solid day, 28 carries for 102 yards, 2 touchdowns. And Nick Westbrook-Ikeem, he had 2 receptions for 72 yards. Now, the Commanders, they weren't bad either. Carson Wentz, we already know his whole dynamic and whatnot, but for the most part, he was actually solid. He went 25 for 38, 359 yards, 2 touchdowns, but he had 1 interception, and that interception came at the worst moment of the game. Welcome back to Brian Robinson. Now, if you guys aren't familiar with the story, Brian Robinson, the rookie running back from Alabama, was shot in the leg about 6-7 weeks ago in an attempted carjacking. But it was his first game back, and it was just amazing to see him back on the field doing something he loves. He actually had 9 carries for 22 yards. Now, Deonte Brown, solid game. 2 receptions for 105 yards and 2 touchdowns. And Terry McLaurin chipped in 5 receptions for 76 yards. Now, again, this is a crazy game. Because, again, the Commanders, they didn't play bad. They really didn't. I mean, they gained 385 yards of total offense compared to the Titans' 241. Ryan Tannehill, he didn't have the huge numbers, but the Titans were able to play their type of game. What I mean their type of game is run the ball and control the tempo of the game. But one stat that is so telling, and again, I've said this in numerous breakdowns, you know, winning football, you got to be able to convert on third down offensively. And on defense, you got to be able to limit a team's third down conversion. And the Commanders, they went 1-for-9 on third down. Couldn't sustain any long drops. And they kept giving the ball back, just again, opportunity after opportunity, to the Tennessee Titans team. Whether you believe it or not, in order for a team to be successful, you gotta be able to convert on third downs. And that's where the Titans, excuse me, that's where the Commanders couldn't, and the Titans did. And they win this game 21-17. Entertaining game right here. San Francisco 49ers to Carolina Panthers. They actually traveled to Carolina to Bank of America Stadium. And again, 49ers, are confident right now. Coming off a dominating win against the LA Rams, they're confident. The team is playing at a high level. Defense looks great. They're running the ball. Jimmy G is actually leading a really solid offense. You know, and he had a solid day, 18 for 30 for 252 yards and 2 touchdowns. Now, Jeff Wilson had 17 carries for 120 yards and 1 touchdown, and Tevin Coleman had 8 carries for 23 yards and another touchdown, as well as 3 receptions for 44 yards and a receiving touchdown. Now, solid production from the running game, solid production from the offense. Brandon Ayuk, 3 receptions for 58 yards, and Deebo Samuel had 2 receptions for 20 yards, but he did have a receiving touchdown. Baker Mayfield struggled, and another consistent or another week of struggling under center and leading out of the Panther offense. He went 20 for 36 for 215 yards, 1 interception. Christian McCaffrey looked good. Run CMC looks good, has looked good this season. 14 carries for 54 yards, 1 touchdown, and 7 receptions for 50 yards. Shree Smith, he led the receivers with 4 receptions for 69 yards, and DJ Moore had 4 receptions for 59 yards. But again, this is about the 49ers, and they came in with some steam and some mojo. You know, again, what they did to the Rams last week, they wanted to continue that dominating showing. And that defense, Coach D'Amico Ryans has his defense plan amazing. They are getting after it, and they didn't disappoint. You know, Jimmy Garoppolo led a well-balanced offense of attack, of rushing and passing the ball. And the defense, again, a second consecutive week of scoring on the defensive side of the ball. They abused the Carolina Panthers. And the 49ers, they're looking like they're in midseason form already. We're still in the beginning parts of the season. And they dominate the Panthers, 37-15. And after the game, Matt Rhule was relieved of his duties as head coach for the Panthers. You know, 3 years in, and again, has not been able to right the ship or turn that team around. So assistant coach, my former DB coach, Steve Wilks, he will serve as interim head coach for the Panthers. Woo! Let's head to Arizona. The only undefeated team in the NFL, the Philadelphia Eagles, traveled to Arizona to take on the Cardinals. Solid, great game, entertaining game. But this game had a lot of situational football, especially in the waning moments of the game and the closing parts of the game. And you can learn a thing or two. Now, Jalen Hurts, he's got to be in the MVP conversation with the likes of Josh Allen and Patrick Mahomes, because the way he's played this year, the way how he's transformed and changed up his game and changed his mechanics and just really went out there and competed, it doesn't go unnoticed. 26 for 36 for 239 yards, 15 carries for 61 yards and 2 rushing touchdowns on the ground. Miles Sanders, 15 carries for 58 yards, and Dallas Goedert, he led them with 7 receptions for 95 yards, while Devontae Smith had 10 receptions for 87 yards. Now, the Cardinals, they weren't too bad, but they're going to be kicking themselves in the end because they shot themselves in the foot in the waning parts of the game. Kyler Murray, not bad, 28 for 42 for 250 yards, 1 touchdown, but he also threw an interception, had 4 carries for 42 yards. James Conner, he led them on the ground with 9 carries for 55 yards. And Eno Benjamin, he chipped in 8 carries for 25 yards and 1 touchdown. Marquise Hollywood Brown had 7 receptions for 78 yards and a touchdown, and Rondale Moore had 7 receptions for 68 yards. But again, this game was more so about the Philadelphia Eagles, and they continue to impress. No matter what, they go out there and compete on hard on the field. They are still the lone beaten, unbeaten team in the NFL, and they use a balanced attack of solid defensive play and running the ball. Yet, the Cardinals, again, they have the opportunities, and they're going to be shooting themselves in the foot after they watch the film. But they mismanagement and poor situational football awareness. And I got to put that on Coach Cliff Kingsbury. You know, with 3rd-and-1, you clock it. You know what? Again, you didn't have your field goal team ready. You know, you could have actually went forward and got a first down and clocked it. And, you know, got a couple of more plays. But, again, you had an opportunity. You didn't. You know what? These are things that are practice. Situational football. Moments like these, because you never know when they're going to show up, but they will show up. And again, the Cardinals, they still had an opportunity to tie the game, but the field goal went wide right, and the Eagles escaped this game with a 20-17 victory. But what this does is it sets up a monster NFC East show-up, our matchup on Sunday Night Football against the Dallas Cowboys, and I'm looking forward to that. Oh, and since we're talking about the Cowboys, let's go ahead and go to L.A. Let's go to SoFi, where the Dallas Cowboys travel to take on the defending Super Bowl champions, the Los Angeles Rams. Now, again, Cooper Rush under center again. And again, one thing he's done, and I'm not going to put like the carriage before the horse, he's won. He's actually done what was Coach Mike McCarthy and Kellen Moore have like really designed and game planning. He hasn't tried to do too much. But I commend the other guys for rallying around him and just really playing their best game. And just again, this Dallas defense, problem. So Cooper didn't have the biggest game, 10 for 16 for 102 yards. Tony Pollard had 8 carries for 86 yards and 1 touchdown. Ezekiel Elliott had 22 carries for 78 yards. Solid rushing production. And you got to be able to do that, run the ball with, you know, with Cooper Rush under center. You know, not no disrespect to his game. He's not Dak. But again, he goes out there and he competes, and he, that's one thing he's done is win. You know, one thing he's done is win. So respect to him. Now, other side of the ball, the Rams are still struggling. Matthew Stafford he's struggling big time, and they gotta fix it. They really gotta fix it. They were exposed again. They were already exposed by the 49ers, but they were exposed again by this Dallas team. Matthew Stafford struggled. 28-42 for 308 yards, 1 touchdown, 1 interception. Couldn't get the running game going either, as Cam Akers led them with 13 carries for 33 yards. Cooper Kupp, monster game. 7 receptions for 125 yards and 1 touchdown. And Tyler Higbee had 7 receptions for 46 yards. But this is another week, another multiple turnover week for Matthew Stafford and the Rams. 2 more lost fumbles and 1 interception. And this is another week where the Rams allow a defensive score. Now, this Rams team, they really needs to find some answers, and it's big. The big question is why they're performing so bad in all phases of the game. Aaron Donald and Cooper Kupp, they really are really the only guys that show up and they come to compete, and they dominate in their respective games. But again, the Cowboys, they didn't have to do too much in the air. They got great ground production. They was able to control the game, actually control the clock. But Dallas's bread and butter is that defense. It's gotten to the point where I honestly believe that most teams would rather the Dallas offense, like play against the Dallas offense, than to have their defense on the field. This defense is very reminiscent of the Seattle Seahawks, Legion of Boom. You know, the Ravens are that vaunted, you know, a Tampa Bay defense. You know, they are Chicago Bears. You know what I'm saying? They get after it, and they get after it in a big way. You know, and this defense is already in midseason form, and they've gotten better and better week in and week out. But the Cowboys, they came in this game as underdogs. Let's not get that. Let's not, you know, overlook that. They came in this as underdogs, and they steal this game. They dominated with defense. They dominated on the ground game. And they get a big win, 22-10. And they set up a big one. And I'm looking forward to this game. A big matchup between the Philadelphia Eagles and the Dallas Cowboys. Oh, it's going to be a great game. So I'm so excited. Now, AFC North Showdown. Between the Cincinnati Bengals and the Baltimore Ravens. Now, these games are always typically close because it's always a one-score game, and these teams know each other very well. The tide has turned so much in that AFC North because before it was just, you know what, it was either going to be the Pittsburgh Steelers or the Baltimore Ravens. But Cincinnati has came. Cleveland is here. They're competing, and this division is like one of the most competitive divisions in all of football. Now, Joe Burrow didn't have the best game, but he was solid. 24 for 35 for 217 yards, 1 touchdown, 1 interception. But he also had 1 8-yard rushing touchdown. I mean, again, these games are defensive fights. And again, who's going to make the most plays when the moment matters and when it's their time? Now, Joe Mixon, 14 carries for 78 yards. And Hayden Hurst, he led them with 6 receptions for 53 yards and 1 receiving touchdown. Jamar Chase also chipped in 7 receptions for 50 yards. But this Ravens team, it's a bad team right there, man. You know, Lamar Jackson, I'm just in awe of him. You know, at 19 for 32 for 174 yards, 1 touchdown, 1 interception, but also had 12 carries for 58 yards. And the bulk of those yards right there came in that final drive. J.K. Dobbins, he had 8 carries for 44 yards. And Mark Andrews looked great. 8 receptions for 89 yards, 1 touchdown. And Devin Duvernay chipped in 5 for 54. But Baltimore missed some opportunities. Before I do anything, Baltimore missed some opportunities. As close as this game was, Cincinnati could actually win it, and they missed some big opportunities. Lamar was not precise, and he was not on point with some of his passes. He missed a lot of plays, and he missed some points out there on the game. But again, close contest. I love it. You know what? Both quarterbacks, they did okay. Not to their liking, but they did okay. What do you expect? These two teams sport really, really good defenses. So again, it's who's going to make the most of the opportunity, who's going to make the most plays. And this is a game that came down to who had the ball last. Lamar Jackson's ability to run the ball. He just has a strong desire and a strong will to will his team to victory. And he showed that in that last drive. And I mean, he helped the Ravens big time with his legs. And he willed this team down the field for a winning Justin Tucker field goal to win this game 19-17. It was a solid game.
All right. Now, to my favorite game. Now, one thing we always said before the year started was that the AFC West, the division with the Raiders, the Chiefs, the Chargers, and the Denver Broncos, that on paper this was going to be
the best best division in all of football. You have Patrick Mahomes, Russell Wilson, Justin Herbert, and Derek Carr. These quarterbacks are all in one division. This game right here, another, whenever the Chiefs and the Raiders play, it's always a close game. It's always a fight. It's competitive. Guys are out there, like, you know, again, talking that talk and going out there competing. You got two of the league's best quarterbacks and Patrick Mahomes and Derek Carr out there competing and going at it. You have Davante Adams, the top receiver, that's just really out there doing his thing. Always a close game. But the Raiders, they came into this game, and Derek Carr, he did not play bad. He did not play horrible. 19-30 for 241 yards, two touchdowns. He did miss a couple of, you know, a couple of opportunities and whatnot. But again, solid. Josh Jacobs. How can I say this? The Raiders declined to pick up this man's fifth-year option, and all he's done is just make play after play after play. Had another solid night. 21 carries for 154 yards, one touchdown. He also had five receptions for 39 yards. Solid production from the running back. I mean, this guy gets after it. The offensive line, they did great last night for paving like the lanes for this guy to go in and hit him. And Davante Adams, monster game. He's had quiet weeks. You know, again, he's had some quiet weeks, but he got back into it with three receptions for 124 yards and two touchdowns. You know, he made some big plays, especially he converted some plays on fourth down and made them into touchdowns. So, again, big game for Davante. Now, Kansas City, on the other hand, we know about this high-powered offense. We know about Patrick Mahomes. We know about what he can do. We know about that, again, they get going, they get going. So, Patrick Mahomes, another monster game. 29 for 43 for 292 yards, four touchdowns, and no interceptions. Carried the ball four times and 28 yards. Now, Jerick McKinnon, nice change of pace back. He actually got going, but he got going in the second half. Eight carries for 53 yards, and you know he had some flashes and some spurts there. Marquez Valdes-Scantling, he actually led them in receiving with six receptions for 90 yards. Mecole Hardman chipped in four receptions for 73 yards, but Travis Kelce had a career evening. And he only had 25 yards on seven receptions, but this guy had four receiving touchdowns. I mean, a career night for Travis Kelce. I mean, wow. But this game right here in itself, AFC West matchup, one possession game, and that's the one thing about the Raiders. The Raiders have given the Chiefs problems over the years. You know, since Patrick Mahomes has taken, you know what, the reign of this team, the Raiders have been a team that has given him trouble. And again, this is a one possession game. Patrick Mahomes, damn fine game. I don't know how many more times I can say it. On top of Travis Kelce's career night. But right now, this is more so less about the Raiders. This is about the Raiders. They had control of the game. They were up 17-0 at one point. Again, and at the end of the first half, they were on top of the Chiefs 20-10. But the second half came, and one thing about the Chiefs is that they're going to fight. And all it takes is one play to get this offense going and to wake them up. Now, there was a couple of questionable calls in this game. A couple of questionable calls, you know, a couple of roughing the passer calls, again, and just some calls on the Raiders side that was questionable. But again, I respect it. Now, the Raiders battled back. They got battled back, and they were actually get at one point one field goal away from tying the game. But Josh McDaniels, he took the chance to just be like, you know what, I'm playing to win and go for a 2-point conversion. Now, I personally, you're questioning it. You know, some people personally will question it. Yet, me personally, you love a coach that's going to, you know what, hey, I'm going to bet on my team. I'm playing to win. I'm not playing not to lose. I'm playing to win. Again, because you got to go out there and you got to stop this Chiefs offense. And the Chiefs were actually scorching the Ravens defense, the Raiders defense. And again, he actually looked at it like, you know what, hey, we're going to have to force them to go down there, and they got to score. So that gives us a little confidence, and it gives us a little bit more breathing room, just a little bit of ounce of breathing room, because knowing what they have to do in the situation of football. But they actually failed the 2-point conversion. And again, something happened. Again, they had a chance on 4th-and-1 to try to, like, you know what, again, to win the game, to get in the field goal range. But you know what, Davante Adams and Hunter Renfrow, they collide on a route, and the Chiefs get a big win, another division win, to stay on top of that division, the AFC West division, 30-29. But man, solid game. I'm solid, amazing game between these two teams. I love the competition. It was just a solid week of football in itself. And I hope everybody just, again, have a beautiful and blessed week. Oh man, continue to fight. It's Taco Tuesday. Go have a couple of tacos, but also continue to persevere. Continue to press through whatever issues, whatever wall that's in your way. Again, the glass is not half empty. It's half full, and you're pouring into it. Don't let nothing get in the way of your dreams and your goals, and I hope everybody has a beautiful and blessed day. Thank you again for supporting, and this is The Breakdown, X's and O's with Nate Ness. Until we see each other again in week 6, y'all have a great day.